18 hours, 1 minute. We have about 2 minutes worth of tape. We'll play that for you now.
Hey, base, this is Houston, over.
Roger, go ahead, Houston.
Roger, on your next depressurization, it's acceptable to use the overhead hatch dump valve in addition to or instead of the forward hatch dump valve to speed up the depressurization of the cabin. I have a T13 update for you, and if you could sometime here give us poo and data, we'll uplink you a new CSM state vector, over.
All right. You've got the Dickey.
Roger, your T13 time is 124.2202, over.
Roger, T13, 124.22, is that 02, over?
That's affirmative, that is 02. And do you have a time estimate for us until you're ready to start cabin depress, over?
15 minutes, maybe.
Roger. Tranquility Base, this is Houston. Uplink complete. The computer is yours, and you can go out of data.
Roger. Go ahead, Tranquility Base here.
Roger, just want to let you guys know that since you're an hour and a half over your timeline and we're all taking a day off tomorrow, we're going to leave you. See you later.
I don't blame you a bit.
That's been a real great day, guys. We really enjoyed it.
Thank you. Couldn't enjoy it as much as we did.
Right.
It was great.
Sure wish you'd hurry up and get that trash out of there, though.
Yeah, we're just about to do it.
Okay.
Now, the Capcom voice on that last transmission was Deke Slayton, the director of flight crew operations here at MSC.
Tranquility Base, this is Houston. We show the suit relief valve still in the auto position. It should be closed, over. Columbia, this is Houston, over.
Houston, call you, go ahead.
Roger, we've successfully reacquired high gain antenna. Unless you have some other traffic with us, I guess we'll bid you a good night and let you get some sleep, Mike, over.
Okay, sounds fine.
And we are going to power down the voice subcarrier part of our uplink to you in order that we don't disturb you while we're talking to Tranquility Base. If you need us, just give us a call and we can respond with a time lag of about a minute to a minute and a half in getting reconfigured, over.
Okay, thank you.
Roger, and good night.
We said goodnight to Mike Collins in Columbia at 114 hours, 6 minutes. And the cabin is coming down now on Tranquility Base. It's down to about 3.5 pounds now, holding there.
Columbia, Columbia, this is Houston. We'd like you to enable thrusters Bravo 1 and Bravo 2, auto RCS select, over.
Okay, Bravo 1, Bravo 2 enable.
Roger out.
Tranquility base pressure coming on down now. 1.5 pounds.
Tranquility, this is Houston. For a reference, which dump valve are you using, over?
The forward dump valve until about 2 psi, and we're using the overhead now.
Roger out.
They're both open now.
Less than 0.5 pound of pressure now. Unofficial time for start of this second depressurization, 114 hours, 8 minutes, 12 seconds. Suit pressure is holding at about 3.9 pounds per square inch. Cabin pressure down to about 1/10 of a pound now. .04 pounds now. There went something. Looked like a portable life support system. Comes the other place. cabin is being repressurized now. The experiments console reports the seismometer recorded both the impacts of those portable life support systems. Cabin pressure up over 1 psi. Up to 2 now. Pounds per square inch. Leveling off about 4.8.
Houston, Tranquility Base, repress complete.
Roger, Tranquility. We observed your equipment jettison on the TV, and the passive seismic experiment recorded shocks when each plus hit the surface. Over.
Can't get away with anything anymore, can you?
No, indeed.
Items scheduled to be jettisoned were the two portable life support systems, a lithium hydroxide canister, and an arm rest from the limb. We expect the crew to turn off the TV very shortly switching over to another telemetry mode when they turn off the TV switch.
Tranquility Base, this is Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
Roger. When you get back into your surface checklist and come over to the comm reconfiguration on page surface 45, we'd like you to enable the ranging feature on your S-band. That is, when you come down to S-band configuration, instead of caution warning electronics, enable TV, we'd like you to go into the range position and leave it there for as long as you conveniently can until you get ready to commence your rest period, and we'll try to get a little more ranging data on you. Over.
Roger, copy.
Now the question, you get ready to turn in, go back into caution and warning enable. And we'd like to say from all of us down here in Houston, and really from all of us in all the countries and in the entire world, we think that you've done a magnificent job up there today. Over.
Thank you very much. It's been a long day.
Yes, indeed. Get some rest there and have at it tomorrow.
Houston, Tranquility, did you all come up with any other solution that we might try to the mission timer problem? Over.
Stand by, Tranquility. We'll be back with you in just a minute.
Houston, Tranquility, have you had enough TV for today?
Tranquility, this is Houston. Yes, indeed, it's been a mighty fine presentation there.
Okay, signing off. See you again tomorrow.
Roger.
And the TV went off at 114 hours. 25 minutes, 47 seconds.
Columbia, Columbia, this is Houston, over. Roger, sorry to bother you, Columbia. Two things. We request that you select 10 degrees dead band in your DAP in accordance with the procedures on Foxtrot 9-7 in your checklist. And secondly, we'd like to leave a display on the disky that is not one that's cycling and being continuously updated. What you have when you get through widening the dead band will be a static display, and that'll be satisfactory. Over.
Okay.
Roger, good night again. Tranquility Base, this is Houston, over.
Roger, go ahead.
Roger, on your mission timer, we wanted to pull the circuit breaker and let it cool down for an hour and a half to 2 hours. I believe the breaker is currently open. It has been off. So go ahead and reset the mission timer circuit breaker. Put the timer control to reset and hold it in reset for 30 seconds, and then slew it to your desired settings, left to right, and place the timer control to start. Over.
Okay, we'll try it. And our mission timer seems to be fluent. Okay, you want to give us a time hack? Or can we get up the CMC? LGC, I mean.
Roger, Tranquility, I'll give you a time hack at 114-3100. It's about 30 seconds from now, over. Stand by for a mark at 114-31. Stand by. Mark. Tranquility, this is Houston. Did you copy my mark at 114-31?
Roger, thank you, and our mission timer is running now.
Roger, very good. And I've got a consumables update for you if you're ready to copy or listen, over.
Stand by. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, RCS Alpha is 81%. RCS Bravo, 75%. Coming up on 115 hours GET, descent oxygen is 31.8 pounds, or 59%. Descent amp hours, 858, and ascent amp hours, 574, over.
Roger, copy, thank you very much.
Roger out. Tranquility, this is Houston. We also have a set of about 10 questions relating to observations you made, things you may have seen during the EVA you can either discuss a little later on this evening or sometime later in the mission. That your option. How do you feel, over?
I guess we can take a couple up now.
Okay, and your friendly green team here has pretty well been relieved by your friendly maroon team, and I'll put Owen on with the questions.
Tranquility.
Okay, thank you, Bruce. And
Go ahead. Tranquility, Houston, first question here is, your best estimate of the yaw on the of the limb as compared to the nominal pre-flight plan, over.
We got 13 degrees left on the ball, and I think that's probably about right. Looking at the shadow and so on, we're probably about 13 degrees left of the shadow.
Roger, that 13 degrees left of the shadow. And next question relates to the depth of the bulk sampling that you obtained near the first part of the EVA, and any changes in composition that you might have observed during the bulk sampling interval, over.
I'm not sure I understand that question, but we got a good bit of the ground mass in the bulk sample, plus a sizable number of selected rock fragments of different types.
Roger, Neil. One of the implications here is the depth from which the bulk sample was collected. Did you manage to get down several inches or nearer the surface, over?
We've got some down from as much as 3 inches in the area where I was looking at the variation with depth in the bulk sample. There really wasn't appreciable difference, and I didn't run into any hard band. Later on, or at some other times in other areas, why I'd get down just a short distance, an inch or two, and couldn't go any further.
Roger, I believe we understand down as deep as 3 inches, did not hit any hard bed, and no significant changes in composition to that depth. Next question, second SRC was packed rather hurriedly due to the time limitation, and I wonder if you would be able to provide any more detailed description of the samples which were included in the second SRC, over.
We got two core tubes and a solar wind and about half of a big sample bag full of of assorted rocks, which I picked up hurriedly from around the area. Tried to get as many representative types as I could.
Roger, Neil. Next topic here relates to the rays which emanate from the DIP's engine burning area. We are wondering if the rays emanating from the beneath the engine are any darker or lighter than the surrounding surface. Over.
That I saw back in the aft end of the spacecraft appeared to be a good bit darker, and of course viewed from the aft end where they did have the sun shining directly on them, it seemed as though the material had been baked somewhat and also scattered in a radially outward direction. But in that particular area, this feature didn't extend more than about 2, maybe 3 feet from the skirt of the engine. Over.
Roger, understand that near the aft end, out to the east, that the rays did appear darker. I understand, Buzz, that these were this was the appearance of the material which had been uncovered by the rays. That appeared darker for 2 or 3 feet extending outward. Is that correct?
No, I wouldn't say it was necessarily material that had been uncovered. I think some of the material might have been baked or in some way caused to be more cohesive and perhaps flow together in some way. I don't know. Now, in other areas, before we started trampling around out in front, why, we could see that small erosion had taken place in a radially outward direction, but it had left no significant mark on the surface other than just having eroded it away. Now, it was different back in the, right under the skirt itself. It seemed as though the surface had been baked in a streaked fashion, and I think a couple pictures on film will show this, but that didn't extend out very far. Over.
Roger, Tranquility, and this baked appearance that you've described, at least the suggestion is that it was due to the heat of the engine at any rate. Next subject, did
I believe so.
Roger, next subject, did either of the solar panels on the PSE touch the surface of the moon during deployment. Over.
I think that that two corners did touch. Since when it was deployed, it both of them did come out at the same time. It unfolded a little unevenly, and of course the terrain that it was on was a little bit not quite as level as it would as I would like to have it, and I think that two corners did touch to about 1 inch or 3/4 to a 1/2 inch deep, and maybe along the bottom it might have been maybe 3 inches, leaving a small triangular coating on two of the corners, and I think these are on the western ones. Over.
Roger, understand the description there. And the next subject, on the two core tubes which you collected, how did the driving force required to collect these tubes compare? Was there any difference? Over.
Not significantly. I could get down about the first 2 inches without much of a problem. And then as I would pound it in about as hard as I could do it, the second one took two hands on the hammer, and I was putting pretty good dents in the top of the extension Right. And it just wouldn't go much more than, I think the total depth might have been about 8 or 9 inches. But even there, it didn't, for some reason, it didn't seem to want to stand up straight. In other words, I'd keep driving it in, and it would dig some sort of a hole, but it wouldn't just penetrate in a way that would support it and keep it from falling over, if that makes any sense at all. It didn't really to me. Over.
Roger, Buzz. I think I've got the picture. You indicate that a little difference between the two samples, and that in each case you got down about 2 inches without any problems, and then had to continue hammering rather vigorously in order to continue driving it into a total depth of 8 or 9 inches, and even at that point the rods did not want to stay vertical, that they'd tend to fall over on you even after pounding in that far. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's about it. It wasn't a rapid change in resistive force. And also I noticed when I took the bit off that the material was quite well packed, a good bit darker, and it the way it adhered to the core tube gave me the distinct impression of being moist. Over.
Roger, understand the general impression of being moist as packed in the core tube. Next question. We did copy your comments prior to the EVA of your general description of the area. We wonder if either of you would have any more lengthy description or more detailed description of the general summary of the geology of the area. Over.
We'll postpone our answer to that one until tomorrow, okay?
Yes, indeed. That'll be fine. Just a couple more here, and I think these may not be quite as lengthy as number 7 there. Can you estimate the stroke of the primary and secondary struts? Over.
Well, I could do it like this, Owen. About all the struts are about equally stroked. And the height from the ground to the first step is about 3 feet, or maybe 3.5 feet, huh?
Roger, understand, Neil. Next topic. As just after landing, you pointed out that there was a hill to the west along the plus Z axis from the limb. Are there any large rocks in that direction that might block the solar array during the sunset, as the sunset approaches in your locality? Are there any large rocks that might tend to obscure the array? Over.
I don't believe so. I think that it's about as level as any other area is, that we chose.
Roger.
There's nothing large anyway that's going to get in the way.
Roger, copy. That's also the way it appeared from the television, I think. And now the final question. You commented, Neil, that on your approach to the landing spot, you had passed over a football field-sized crater containing rather large blocks of solid rock, perhaps 10, 15 feet in size. Can you estimate the distance to this football-sized crater from your present position? Over.
I thought we'd be close enough so that when we got outside, we could see its rim back there, but I couldn't. But I don't think that we're more than a half mile beyond it. That is, a half mile west of it.
Roger. So you estimate your present position less than a half a mile approximately west of this large crater. Over.
That's correct.
Okay, well, that takes care of the questions from our geologist for tonight, and unless you have something else, that'll be all for, from us for the evening. Over.
Okay, thank you.
The Capcom there was astronaut Owen Garriott, one of the group of five scientist astronauts selected in 1965.
Tranquility Bay, Houston, we've now collected all the ranging data that we can use, and you can go back to caution and warning enable. Over.
Roger, will do.
Thank you. Tranquility Base, Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
Roger, two more verifications here. Will you verify that the disc with messages was placed on the surface as planned, and also that the items listed in the flight plan, all of those listed there, were jettisoned, over.
All that's verified.
Roger, thank you, and I hope this will be the final good night.
Okay.
Tranquility Base has confirmed that they left on the lunar surface all the items they had planned to. We have said goodnight to Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. We will continue to monitor throughout this rest period, which is scheduled to end at about 122 hours elapsed time. We're now 114 hours, 53 minutes. Should there be any further conversations with either Tranquility Base or Columbia, we will come back up and bring those to you. This is Mission Control, Houston.
Thank you.
This is Apollo Control at 115 hours, 50 minutes. It's been almost an hour since we said goodnight to Tranquility Base. Dr. Kenneth Beers, the flight surgeon on this shift, reports that he does not believe that Neil Armstrong is asleep yet. From his heart rate, he thinks he's resting and perhaps dozing from time to time, but he doesn't believe that he's asleep. Neil is the only one being monitored in Tranquility Base. There is no biomedical instrumentation for Buzz Aldrin. Dr. Beers reports Mike Collins is sound asleep in Columbia as it orbits the moon. Columbia has just entered its 21st revolution of the moon. All systems on the lunar module are in good order, showing cabin pressure 4.9 pounds per square inch, cabin temperature 62 degrees Fahrenheit. We have not heard from Tranquility Base since saying goodnight, and we have not attempted to call them. This is Mission Control, Houston. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
This is Apollo Control at 116 hours, 50 minutes. All systems in both Columbia and Tranquility Base still operating very well. No problems. Dr. Kenneth Beer's report is the same as the one an hour ago. The data from Neil Armstrong indicates he is resting, but he's not believed to be asleep. He's not following the pattern of sleep, but he is resting. Cabin pressure is holding steady at 4.9 pounds per square inch. Temperature at 62 degrees Fahrenheit. The consumables in Tranquility Base are still in good shape. We're showing 45.5% of the descent water still remaining. Water very important for cooling on the lunar surface. Showing 63% of the oxygen supply in the descent stage still remaining. Both of those consumables in the ascent stage very high, have not been used yet. Two water tanks in the ascent stage, one showing 97.6%, the other showing 98.4%. Two oxygen tanks in the ascent stage, one reading 93.5%, the other 96.8%. Mike Collins still asleep in Columbia. At 116 hours, 52 minutes, all still going well with both spacecraft. This is Mission Control, Houston.